Hi Craft Clubbers, my name is Chris and I'm a maker and quilter. Today I'm going to teach you how to make a modern mini quilt using your own design as the paper piecing template. We're going to be using an English paper piecing technique, which is actually a traditional technique, but with a few modern tricks and tips, you'll save a little bit of time and a little bit of patience and create something that is fun, modern, and unique to you. Before we get started, I'm going to talk through some of the equipment and materials you'll need and tell you a little bit more about how you go about making a quilt. In terms of equipment, you're going to need a pen and pencil. If you've got a fabric marker, that works great for marking fabric before you cut it, but if you haven't, you can make do with just a regular pen or pencil, and also an eraser for fixing any mistakes you make along the way. You'll also need a ruler for drawing your lines, and a pair of scissors you can use to cut paper, and a sharp pair of scissors you can use to cut fabric. You'll also need a glue stick, some needles, and some safety pins. In terms of materials, we'll be starting using A4 card to design and draw your templates. You'll also need some fabrics. Now you can use any kind of fabric you like, but recommended by me is some cotton or craft prints. These are prints that come in all sorts of different colors and styles. What's great about this is you can get them in very traditional looking styles, or you can get them in quite modern geometric styles like the ones that I'm choosing to use today. It would be great if you could have some scraps for using up and some bigger pieces, but whatever you can find in your cupboard or gather through your craft club should be just fine. If you want to use other materials, that's fine as well. But as a beginner, I would stay away from anything that is elastic or stretchy, because that makes it a little bit harder for your first project. You're also going to need some wadding. This wadding is a cotton wadding, but you could use polyester or bamboo. For a project like this, go for something cheap and cheerful like cotton or polyester. You'll need just a piece that's about 6 inches, big enough to go inside your mini quilt. You're also going to need some thread, some good strong thread. I like to use a white color because it's easier to see while I'm stitching, but you can use any color that you have handy. Now before we get started, I'm going to talk you through the three basic steps to making a quilt. First, you need to make your patchwork. That's the intricate pattern, the beautiful pattern and design that you see on the front of the quilt. The next step will be to layer your patchwork with a wadding like this and a backing fabric and do the actual quilting. The quilting is when you take a needle and sew through all layers together. This is decorative because it adds another layer of decoration to the project, but it's also for strengthening and reinforcing your quilt. Finally, you'll take your backing fabric and fold it over the edges of the quilt to tidy up the raw edges and finish your mini quilt. These are the three steps it takes to make any quilt. So once you get your confidence up and can make a quilt this big, you can make a quilt as big as you want to. But my motto is start small. Start with something small so that you have fun and enjoy making your quilt, and then build up the confidence and skills to tackle your dream project. If you start with the aim of making something massive, then you might find that the pressure and stress take the fun out of it. So get your materials, get your equipment together, set aside a little bit of time, and in the next steps, I'll teach you how to make your mini quilt. Let's get started. Okay, we're ready to make our quilt. Draw yourself a 6-inch square on a piece of A4 card, and using a ruler and pencil, create a design drawing straight lines wherever you'd like. There are a few rules to follow, but generally if you're drawing straight lines, either segments from one side to another or directly across, you'll create something that can be recreated as a quilt. Draw lines to create shapes like triangles, squares, pentagons, hexagons, all kinds of shapes, and from there you'll play with a design and come up with something that works for you. If you're not sure where to start, have a look at tiled floors, fabrics, anything that you see as a design on a flat surface can be recreated with shapes on a quilt. If you have a set of tangrams or blocks or shapes that you could play with, then you could always use those to physically sketch out a design as well. I'm doing a simple design that involves three large triangles that touch the edges but overlap to form some mini triangles in place. If you want to start easy, just draw two lines and create four angular pieces. The more lines you add, the harder it will be to make. So think about how much of a challenge you're up for and design accordingly. There's only one design rule that you have to follow. Apart from using straight lines, you have to stick to something we call convex polygons. These convex polygons have angles that face outwards. This may sound complicated, but what it means is that if you want to have something like a star shape or something that has angles that face inside, you then have to break that up in a way that turns it into a set of convex polygons. So for example, I could take this star and join the lines around the middle. So instead of one shape with inward facing angles, I have five triangles and one pentagon. These shapes together can then be joined with other shapes and other lines and squared off into a 6-inch square. Once you have your design finished in full, it's time to cut it out. And use your paper scissors. The only rule for cutting it out is to treat it like a jigsaw puzzle, with the understanding that every piece has to be able to connect with the pieces next to it. So you don't want to trim little slivers out or different pieces. You want to make nice, long cuts so that each piece comes out as one. Once you've cut all your pieces, lay them out on the table like this and make sure that they all fit together nicely. You want to put the puzzle back together before you start your next steps. And at that time, it's probably a good idea to number them. I've tried to number them roughly, going clockwise, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, and then 11 snuck back in there. The other thing that's worth doing is marking any edges that are the outside edges. If you mark all the outside edges, then you'll be able to come back to it if you get all your pieces mixed up. It will also come in handy to know which edges are your outside edges when it comes to the next stage, which is cutting and playing with fabrics. Now that you've got a design, you need to use these paper piece templates to create the fabric parts of your patchwork. Starting with one, lay it down onto a piece of fabric. And what you want to have is roughly 1/4 inch, which is about that much, around all edges of your paper pieces. So I'm going to tell you to trace your paper piece, but I don't mean to trace it just like this along the edges. I mean to trace it using a 1/4 inch edge so that you've drawn your pieces a bit too big. I'm now going to cut this out. And it doesn't have to be perfect. These projects are designed to be really forgiving. So we have one piece cut like this with a 1/4 inch around, and I'm going to cut one more. Just try to find a place where it fits. The benefit of numbering your pieces is that you also know which is the right side and wrong side of your quilt, so that you don't accidentally turn them over and put them wrong side up or right side up. And when we're cutting out our fabric, we're matching the wrong side of our template to the wrong side of our fabric. So again, just roughly, this should be a quarter inch on either side, and I'm going to trim my pieces. Now, you can see that these edges are not perfect, but it doesn't matter because they're going to be hidden inside my quilt. For this piece, which is an interior piece of the patchwork, it has no outside edges, I'm going to place it onto my fabric and, using my mini glue stick, put a light layer of glue down and then tack my fabric in place. Don't worry, this is enough to hold it in place, but it won't be permanent. Then I'll go around all the edges, tacking edges in place, one after the other, until my piece is completely covered. That means I now have one piece where I see the right side, the numbered side of my template, and on the other side, the right side of the fabric. Don't worry about these little flags and tails. They'll disappear into your quilt as you stitch. For this piece, which has two outside edges, I'm going to only fold my seam allowance over and only tack the edges on the internal edges. And I'll explain that in a second. So I'm going to do one long swipe of glue, tack that into place, and then, just to make sure things don't move too much, I'm going to put a little bit of glue on my fabric to hold that in place. And you'll see when I put it back with the rest of my pieces, that's because when I put my quilt together, or if I was going to attach my block to other blocks, I'll need a quarter inch seam allowance all the way around my block. You can always trim your block down later, but if you give yourself a generous allowance, then it'll be a lot easier getting started. Once you have your pieces covered in fabric and you've done all your pieces, you can then start to sew them together. I'm going to set these aside and show you the sewing with just these two pieces. You'll need a needle and thread. It's good to thread with a length of thread that is no longer or just about as long as your forearm. You might think having a really long piece of thread will save you time because you won't have to thread your needle over and over again, but it's much more likely to get knotted as you go. Then pick up your pieces and nestle them together edge to edge so you can feel the points of the polygons. And once you've got them neatly in place, here's a little tip. Use a big paperclip or a small paperclip just to hold them together exactly where these points and edges meet. Then, using your needle and thread, begin to sew them together. Your needle should just pass through both fabrics just above the card. You shouldn't feel like you're forcing your needle through card. Now I'm going to, for my first stitch, put the needle through twice and loop it through the thread before I pull it tightly. And that's just going to give me a little bit of a knot to hold my thread in place. It's important when you stitch to sew so that your needle cuts across these pieces running parallel, perpendicular to them, because that will mean that the stitch that crosses the fabric is small and straight, and the stitch, the side that travels, is hidden inside your quilt. To show you what I mean, I'll show you once more the needle going directly across. That's the right way to do it. The wrong way would be to put your needle on a diagonal, because then that long stitch will show on the good side of your patchwork. So stitch after stitch, where your needle passes just above the card, but through both fabrics. And I would say that maybe 4 or 5 stitches per centimeter is your minimum, but if you'd like, you can do even tinier stitches. So keep doing this, adding stitches after stitch. You can see it's going pretty quickly, and eventually you'll get to the end of this row, bring in a second and third piece, and finally assemble your whole piece of patchwork. Once you complete your whole piece, you might find that as the last few pieces come in, you have to sort of fold and bend your patchwork to get it in place. But what you should end up with is all of your pieces sewn together with a bit of a seam allowance along the outside. And again, it doesn't have to be perfect. If you look really closely, you may be able to see the stitches on the right side, and that's okay. No hand-sewn patchwork is perfect. You're going to see the stitches, but the idea is that you have a messy side that shows all your long ends of threads and stitches, and a good side. From there, what you want to do is start to peel back the edges of your seam allowance. And when you do that, you might need to be a little bit flexible and bendy with your piece. Sometimes it helps to pick it up and bend it in different ways. But as you do that, your paper pieces should tear out. And if you look up close at the paper pieces, you'll see they have a slightly perforated edge. And that's where the needle just grazed through past the edge of the paper, but you weren't punching through, you weren't puncturing the thread, you were just grazing it. So you should end up with these neat little paper pieces. And slowly but surely, they will peel out. If your glue is really dry, then they should come out a bit easier. It's when your glue is still a little wet that it's sticky. If you struggle with getting your paper pieces out, then you could try steaming it with an iron. Get the help of an adult or somebody that knows how to use an iron safely. So I'm just going to finish pulling my pieces off one by one. And quite soon, I should have my patchwork. After all of that, I've pulled my paper pieces out, and I have my piece of patchwork. You might need to square it off and trim it. I've already done that, so it's nice and square. And then you need to get your wadding and backing. I've cut a backing piece and a wadding piece. You should notice the wadding is cut to the same size as my mini quilt, which is started as a 6-inch block, but when you add those edges, becomes 6.5 inches. So my wadding is the same size, and then my backing fabric is actually 1 inch bigger. So my backing fabric is actually 7.5 inch square. And I'm just going to lay them in place. And this is the quilt sandwich that I was talking about earlier. You take your patchwork, you take your wadding and your backing fabric and lay them together nicely. Then take a couple of safety pins to hold them in place. You might need some help from an adult with this, depending on how sharp your pins are. But what you want to do is push your pins through all 3 layers of your quilt sandwich so that they come out the other side. And this is more important if you're working on a really large project, because once you start your quilting, you want everything to be nicely in place. If you're working on a small project like this,
You could maybe hold it in place, but you want to be sure of what you're doing. So now I have a basted quilt sandwich, and I'm going to do the quilting. Quilting can be done with thin thread, similar to the thread we stitched with, or you can use all kinds of thick, decorative, metallic, all kinds of threads, because it really is a combination of a strong stitch to hold your quilt together and a decorative stitch. And what you want to do with your quilting is follow any design you like. Come up through the inside of your quilt sandwich and add some stitches that you think suit your piece. You can follow the lines of your stitching where your seams are. That's called stitching in the ditch because you don't notice them so much. They seem to hide away. Or you can do what I'm doing and just freestyle add some lines using a thick thread. This gives a little bit of reinforcement to your quilt as well as some texture. You're gonna want to stitch one or two lines, as many as you like, depending on the time and the patience that you have. But what you're aiming for are quilting lines that either follow the lines of the patchwork or cross and touch into all the different sections of your patchwork. And on the other side, come through your fabric so that they're holding all the layers together. So I'm going to finish up my quilting and then come back and show you the next step for doing the binding. Okay, so I finished my quilting. I've decided to go with one meandering line through the quilt. You could fill your mini quilt with lots of straight lines, lots of wavy lines, as much as you like, but I've chosen to go with something quite simple. Now we have our piece layered together, and the last step is to create the binding from the back so that all these raw edges now disappear. So we're going to start by folding our binding in on itself, and then again by folding it over the quilt. So this back will form a little bit of a binding. Now, you could do this with an iron just to press everything in place, but you can also just, again, use a paper clip to help hold things in place as you go. I would normally do this with white thread, but so that you can see how the stitching works, I'm going to use a dark and bright blue thread. And all we do is use something called a ladder stitch to tack the edge of this binding down to the quilt. So my first stitch goes into the edge of the binding, and you can do this with wool or yarn. You can do this with quite chunky pieces of thread. You don't have to do it with a little needle and tiny thing. If you've got little hands or you're working with little hands, then you can use bigger needles and threads. And all I'm going to do is run through my binding, then through my quilt, just about a quarter inch in from where it sits, and then back through my binding and through my quilt. And as I go through this, I'm not going to pull it tight. You will pull it tight as you go, but I'm not going to, so you can see it and why it's called a ladder stitch, because I'm literally making stitches, one stitch at a time, across and then under through my quilt. I'm not going all the way through, I'm just going through my top layers of my sandwich, but getting it nicely in there in the wadding. And then I create this little ladder. And when I pull my thread tight, that ladder affixes my binding to my quilt. So I'll go around the exterior of my quilt. And now that you've seen it tighten up and see how it works, I'll tighten as I go. So continue to sew. Oops. Until you get to the corner. And then, using your needle, put a stitch in place to get to the corner of your quilt. And from here, we will fold a half fold in to this little angle, so a 45 degree angle. And then we will start to fold the next side in on itself the same way. And you know, you could use a little bit of glue stick or some heat from an iron to set it. But what we want is a little diagonal fold and then another half fold to get that in place. Don't worry about where your thread is right now, because you will then starting put a little thread through that corner and then start the same thing down this side, threading a ladder stitch through your the edge of your quilt and through your binding. And as you go, just tighten it a little bit so that everything fits nicely in place. And as you get more confident with it, you can do slightly bigger stitches. You can try different stitch lengths, but it's this ladder stitch that it's nice and easy to do. It's very quick, as you can see. And what's beautiful is all of your little threads get hidden away. So I'm going to continue with that, repeating the same thing at each corner. When you get to the end, it's just a matter of putting a knot at the tail where you started and stitching those into the quilt so that they're hidden away. And from there, you're done.
Once you've stitched all the way around your binding, you'll have completed your block. There may be a few loose threads that need tying up, or a few pieces that need tacking or stitching into place. But overall, you should have completed your mini quilt. I hope you've had fun making your mini quilt. The next time you start to do this, try making a more complicated design inside your paper piecing, or make a bigger block, just to see how much more you can do and to learn a bit more about your own style and way of working. You can also work in your craft club and get everybody making a different block that then come together to make a collaborative patchwork quilt to represent your group. I'd love to see how you got on with this, so please share what you've done with Craft Club at craftclub.org.uk, or you can share it on Twitter following @craftclubuk. Or you can visit my website, chrismakesthings.co.uk, where I share a little bit more about the making that I do and have a list of other tutorials, some of which are using just a needle and a thread, just like this one. I hope you've had a great time and that you continue to make patchwork one mini quilt at a time.